Hey guys, how's it going? So in today's video, I want to take a look back at 2019 and show you guys some of the plants and talk about the plants that did really well for us. This is going to be part one of two because today I want to specifically talk about annuals that did really well in the landscape for us. And then we'll come back and talk about annuals and containers and combination planters. So I've got my computer in front of me so I can see all of the pictures that I have saved here. But if you were to ask me my number one favorite plant from this past year that really stood out of all the plants we put in the ground, I would say it would be the Color Blaze Golden Dreams Coleus. We planted a bunch of them in front of our gazebo and it was just the most amazing plant. I think I should probably preface this whole thing by saying we are zone 5, garden in zone 5. It's very hot and dry, we don't have very much humidity, and we have a lot of wind and high pH. So it's like all the bad things. It can be a very harsh growing environment for plants. So I always looked at coleus as being like this tender plant you had to find a shaded spot for. It couldn't take the sun, but the Color Blaze series, including this Golden Dreams, it says on their tag that they can take full sun or full shade. And I thought, well, we'll see if it can take full sun in our area. So I pushed the boundaries this year, past any boundary that I've ever set on coleus anyway. And in front of the gazebo, it gets at least 8 hours of sun throughout the course of the day. Does get protection like right at the end of the day, like that very late afternoon, early evening sun, which can be quite intense. So that may be what was the saving grace with this coleus. But it got a lot of sun throughout the rest of the day. And this plant did so amazing. It got, I wanna say, close to 30 inches tall, if not a little taller. The branches, like the stalks on this plant, were like trunks. I mean, they were so big. So I learned, one, it can handle sun, especially if you've got regular irrigation to it. So we have a drip system in that area. I did have to supplement water once a day when it got above 100 degrees. So I did notice the coleus kind of like wilting down a little bit when it was like 105 or whatever, 102. And then we'd go out and give it a little bit of extra with the hose, which for most of the areas in my garden, I don't want to have to do that. But if it's just little pockets here and there and you're getting so much back from the plant, I think it was completely worth it in this case. I kind of planted those flower beds brand new this last year. So there was some carding mill roses on one side of our gazebo opening. That was my favorite combination from this last year, the carding mill rose with the Golden Dreams coleus. Something about that color combination for me just spoke to me. And then on the other side, I had Boscobel, I believe, roses, which are more of a pink. And then I had purple Illusion, Veronica below it, and some Serendipity Alliums. And it was just a really pretty area. And it's something I definitely want to plant more of because not only did it look beautiful in the landscape, but I cut that coleus a lot for arrangements. So I used it in flower arrangements all the time. And like one specifically that I can remember, and I do think I saved a picture. Yeah, here it is. I used it kind of as my centerpiece. Like it is front and center in the arrangement and it looks so pretty with all those apricot colors. So the next coleus that I really enjoyed was called Ridiculous. The Ridiculous is just a really saturated deep red. And you guys know I'm not a huge red flower lover, but anything with red leaves, I love it. And I think that every garden needs it, you know, scattered throughout because it brings some depth and contrast. I planted it up kind of by our fireplace walkway area in a big kind of drift, like a big clump of it. And I think I planted, oh, I can't remember, 7 or 8 in that spot, and it filled in and got enormous, and it doesn't bloom either, and neither did the Color Blaze Golden Dreams. And that's another thing about coleus. A lot of people, including myself, like I don't grow it for the blooms, I grow it for the leaves. And so I want a coleus, preferably, that doesn't want to bloom all the time, which a lot of the older varieties do. And these set very little blooms, and if they do, it's really late in the season, so you're not like a slave to deadheading all season long to keep them looking clean. But I planted those Ridiculous right behind some Super Tunia Morning Glory Charm, and it was a really pretty blend. I also planted them up along another flower bed area, kind of behind some Munstead Lavender, by some Lemon Zest Roses, and there's incredible hydrangeas behind that. That is something I probably will repeat in that area and make it bigger. So I think having like our boxwood hedge with our incredible hydrangeas, then a big swoop of that Ridiculous will be just such a glorious look right there. Anyway, I just really, really love that. I even planted some Ridiculous. I'm just trying to make sure I don't forget any of the spots because I planted that in another area too. I think right behind our chicken coop, kind of by my pineapple fountain. I think I had 3 or 4 left over from those other planting projects. So I just popped them in the ground right there in front of a blue spruce. And I think that blue and red was just such a beautiful combination. And before I move on to the next coleus, you can see that Ridiculous that's kind of by my Munstead Lavender kind of peeking out from behind, like where I did my fall containers this fall. And it's just so like, that's what I see. I almost don't even see my fall containers. I just see like this coleus in the background. Just like, it begs for attention. It's just so beautiful. Okay, so the next coleus is velveteen. I planted a big drift of velveteen right underneath our weeping willow tree in front of our Hebe statue. And there's some limelight hydrangeas kind of right around Hebe. And then right in front of that, the velveteen coleus. And it filled in really well. Now, it did not get as much sun as the other areas did. So like the golden dreams and the ridiculous got more sun and it did get bigger. So that was interesting to me. The velveteen was shaded for a lot of the day. And then, you know, the canopy of the weeping willow, it grows so fast that it always kind of grows over the front and shades it in the afternoon just a little bit. It's more dappled. So I was interested to see that that one stayed about half as high as the other coleus when usually it wants to get, you know, fairly good size, which was okay in that area, but it was something that like I log away. Those are the kinds of things that's good to learn throughout the years. But the velveteen is beautiful. It's got like the kind of maroon margin with the lighter pink center. So it brings a lot of dimension. Wicked Hot was one I planted in the landscape, and it was one of my favorite views in the garden in terms of plant layering toward the end of the season or middle to end of the season. Once it was really big and full, you could look from one area and you could see Lamium. And then I planted a big drift of white Gomphrena, and then there's Wicked Hot, and then there was a Viburnum right above that. It was just so pretty. I mean, it just was the most beautiful plant layering area of my garden. Like I always just wanted to take pictures of that. Wicked Hot is new for this year, and I was really happy because I planted that one both in containers and in the landscape just to try it out and kind of put it through its paces, the paces, and it really held up and did well. And that one's got more of like a kind of like a hot red appearance and a nice serrated leaf. It was just, it's a nice one. The very last coleus that I had, it's not the last coleus I planted, but the last one, I think Lime Time is in the Color Blaze series, isn't it? Yeah, it's a Color Blaze, so it can do sun or shade as well. But it was just such a beautiful mix. It's something I might repeat there. So I've got like a little grouping of Limetta hydrangeas, and then I've got the Lime Time coleus, and then in front of that, Super Tunia Morning Glory Charm and my Lamb's Ear. And it was just a really bright, almost, it was a needed pop of chartreuse in that area. All right, so the next area that I really enjoyed was the urn in Versailles, around the urn in Versailles. You guys know I have Denim and Lace Russian Sage planted around the very base of that urn, and then at the very edge of that flower bed, I planted Sprinter Boxwoods, which when I planted them, they were like this big. Some of you might remember it. They were tiny little boxwoods, and I was just trying to show you guys how, like, you see these big, beautiful gardens in magazines that are like look perfect, and other than the fact that they're probably staged a little bit, it takes a lot of years, a lot of time to get gardens to that full maturity and looking like that. So I just wanted it to be an encouragement to show you guys this tiny little boxwood hedge going in, and it looks amazing now. Like, it's the first year that the boxwoods are wanting to touch each other. And it's just, it's so nice. I haven't had to replace a single one of those boxwoods. And I planted those the fall that right before we got 52 inches of snow. So they were under snow for most of, for months, and not a single broken branch or anything. And I'm kind of getting off track because that's not what I wanted to talk about. But the plants I put in between the Russian Sage and the Sprinters this year were Supertunia Limoncello and Dark Knight Lobularia or Alyssum. And I think that those two are some of my favorite colors in the garden anyway. I love that soft buttery yellow color, and then any color of purple, I just love. And I think that it was the first year we had irrigation brought to that area, because prior I was having to supplement one side with a hose and the other side got overhead water from a sprinkler. This year we had no overhead water to that area, and we ran a single, right Erin, a single brown drip tube all the way around. And so it goes kind of in between. I kind of dotted those annuals kind of in a zigzag pattern. So I put that one drip tube around that because the Denim and Lace doesn't want very much water at all. And now that the Sprinters are established, they're a little bit more low maintenance in terms of water, but it was the perfect mix because I never had to supplement. That water went off once a day. It was perfect for the plants. And by the end of the season, the thing I appreciated about these is that they started to come between the boxwoods, but not like they have in previous years. There was one year I planted Supertunia Bordeaux and a White Knight or Snow Princess Alyssum, and I planted them really early in the season, and they took, like, they got huge and massive, and they were pushing through the boxwoods, which is fine. I mean, they were full of color, but I would prefer them being a little bit more on the restrained side of things for that spot. And these two plants did really well. Like, they intermingled really well together. They didn't try to push out too much in, like, past the boxwoods. And then you can see in one of these pictures in particular, you can see in the background, and this kind of brings me to my next like in-ground planting that did really well. Around Persephone, we planted Supertunia Vista Paradise. So I want to talk about two Supertunia Vistas in particular. So the Vista Paradise was a new one last year, I believe. And the Vista series of Supertunia are the most appropriate and the most vigorous for landscapes. So in case you want to know that, like, if you have areas you want to fill up fast with color, like if you have an event or if you just want that color, put a Supertunia Vista in the ground, because while you might plant like in an area, let's say like this big, maybe you put 3 or 5 traditional type petunias, you put one Vista in the center of this area and it will fill it. They are so amazingly vigorous, and they can handle a little bit more, I think, abuse than other petunias, even Supertunias. Like, they can handle a little more overhead water, because that's all this Vista Paradise got, was overhead water from our grass sprinklers. And it doesn't, this area is very weird in terms of lighting, because there's two honey locust trees that go over that area. So it gets a little bit of morning sun, very dappled through the day, and then a little bit of afternoon sun just on the front side. But still, the Vista Paradise seemed to fill in no matter whether it was getting less sun in the back or more sun in the front. And so I really appreciate that, especially in areas where I need things to look fairly balanced and uniform. It really did well. And you can see based on this picture that the bloom count is insane. So most of the season, I mean, so long as we're keeping up on our budworm preventative spray and keeping up with fertilizer, which we do on a weekly basis, these plants have more blooms than leaves, or that's how they appear, which is amazing. When you're planting annuals, that's what you want, right? We want high drama, high bloom count, high color. So the other Supertunia Vista was one we were trying out last year, which is new this year, and I think you guys should try it. It's called Vista Snowdrift. So this one, I know it's white, and some of you guys want color. I get that. Aaron is like that. He wants like high color. I love white gardens. I love the simplicity and the peaceful nature of a white garden. So we tried out this Vista Snowdrift. I was so excited that there was a white Vista available now. We put 6 around each one of our Red Point maples on the west side of our house. And when we got done, I took a picture and I was like, I've never planted things so scantily in my entire life. And Aaron said, no, we should just plant them very, like, give them space to grow. They'll fill in. And looking at it in the beginning, I thought, no, they'll never get that big. And they did. It's crazy. They got so thick and so full of color. Like, that's probably what if I do Supertunias in that area again, specifically the Vistas, I'll probably just plant 6 again instead of planting maybe like 15 of something else. So in the end, if you're choosing those types of Supertunias over others, I know that's not what this video is about, but they really do have an amazing growth rate. We did try the Vista Snowdrift. I just think this bears mentioning, even though it's in containers. We did a bunch of containers along my parents' driveway that they just had built and put up there. I did purple fountain grass in the center, and then 8 Supertunia Vista Snowdrifts, which was probably too many for those pots. We didn't need to put that many. I could have probably done half that much, but they did fill in a lot faster. I mean, that just is obvious. You know, you put more in, it's gonna fill in faster. But if you were wanting to like go more budget, you could definitely do half the amount with that type of plant, and it would have filled those containers by the end. They got enormous. And the thing about this one that I noticed is a lot of Supertunias, you kind of like think of them as just a spilling plant. They just trail over and create a ton of color. But the Snowdrift, like, it mounded up really well. In fact, for a while there, we were thinking it was just gonna swallow up the grasses, but the grasses pushed through once we had enough heat consistently. The grasses really did their thing, but we had both a filler and a spiller with that Snowdrift. So I thought that was really beautiful. Okay, so the next area I wanna talk about are the front cutouts right in front of the formal entrance of the old side of our house. We plant it up different every single year, and I learn something new every single year every time we do this, because these areas are strange. They get overhead water from sprinklers, so the plants have to be able to handle that. We have very hard water, so they have to be able to stand up to that kind of like mineral deposits on the plant. And so, like previous years, I planted meteor shower verbena, which was so beautiful. I love that plant. And it was beautiful up there for most of the season, and then eventually the hard water got to it. And it had built up such a like crust on the plant that they eventually kind of pooped out by the end. This last year I did Truffula Pink Gomphrena, which is the first time I planted that one, because I think it was brand new last year? It was really a newer variety. And I planted that alongside Supertunia Morning Glory Charm, which was one I used a lot of this last year, and then Lemon Coral Sedum. That Gomphrena, I could have planted like a quarter of the amount that I planted up in this area. I mean, it was a glorious show, but you guys, these plants get huge. Like you get this little white can with, you know, just a couple little stems and you think, well, I'm just gonna, you know, I'm gonna do like 25 in this area, like this little tiny area, because I want it to be really full. Well, you only need like five. I mean, it's just these plants get so big and really quickly, and they held up to the hard water. They bloomed profusely. I never had to deadhead. One thing about this plant though, and I've talked to a lot of people at Proven Winners who have also planted this quite a number of times, I noticed that it has a weird smell. So it kind of smelled like body odor. Like, to be completely honest, I couldn't figure out what the smell was up there. Like, at first it smelled kind of onion-esque. And I'm thinking, what in the world? Like, do I have something up here? Do I have some kind of allium? And I was looking around, and then I thought, you know, I couldn't figure it out. And then one day I was weeding and I got close to one of the blooms and I realized that the plant, maybe it was just our soil or our water type, or the fact that I had so many of them planted together that it was creating this nice aroma up by, of course, our front entryway. Everybody else that's planted it said they had absolutely no issue with that smell. Like, they've never smelled that before. So it could have just been me, but I just have to like make sure that you guys know that it did have an aroma for us. Some might say it's a little off-putting. The plant though itself is amazing. And it is one that I already have plans on putting in somewhere else this next year and trying it somewhere else. It also makes for a great dried flower. So I've cut a bunch of it for arrangements. I made a wreath out of it, which I have sitting. It's all dried and ready to go. I'm gonna put it out for like around Valentine's Day. So I just think it's a really nice plant. Also very drought tolerant once it's kind of established in the ground. Supertunia Morning Glory Charm up there did really well and it held its own for most of the season. Usually up in that area every time, and I think every year we've put a Supertunia up there, but usually by the end of the season, they kind of succumb to the amount of water they're being given eventually. And they kind of start to yellow just a tiny bit, even with our consistent fertilizer. But we've really got to figure out a way to separate the water from the grass and those flower beds. And we will eventually. It's just kind of like not really high on the priority list yet. Lemon Coral Sedum will grow no matter where you put it. I'm convinced. Like, Lemon Coral brings such a nice bright pop of color. We had it, in fact, the next area I'm going to talk about had it as well. And I just kind of like popped it all over the place this year. I had it in containers, I had it in window boxes, I had it up here, I had it in the next area, brick circle area we'll talk about, but it's just an amazing plant. And it lasted for a long time throughout the season. Like, I have some I brought in and they're up in my plant room under some grow lights right now. So you can winter that plant over. It's like a zone 7, I think. If you leave it out in the landscape, it lasted until probably mid-November for me, which I think is a really long time for an annual. So yes, that brings me to my next area, which is the brick raised bed, which is kind of this random big brick circle in the middle of our brick patio. We can't really figure out that area exactly. The previous owner said that there's actually a concrete pad underneath all those bricks. I don't know, I haven't dug down there. So I don't really know what's in that brick raised bed, except for when we moved in, it was full of like native cactus and there was some like catmint and lavender and stuff like that. There was no irrigation to that area. So the last 2 years we've planted it. Last year it was kind of a last minute decision to plant. So I wasn't super happy with what I put in there. They all did really well, but I planted two things that had very dark colored foliage because it was the only things I could get my hands on a lot of. So anyway, this year was really pretty. We did King Tut's in the center, which, you know, kind of thinking later on in the season, it probably wasn't the best spot. King Tut's get huge. And if you put them in a really high wind area, you either need to stake them up like preventatively or just put them somewhere where they're more protected. When we planted them alongside our barn, they were on the east side of our barn and they were protected from all that western wind and they were beautiful and enormous. And I never had any problem with them tipping or wanting to blow over. In this brick area, they were completely exposed. So by the end, they were looking a little bit like I went out with stakes and tried my best to stake them up, but something to note for further years. Right below that, plain the blue salvia, one of my favorite annuals ever, just because it grows without really having to do anything to it. You don't ever have to touch it, basically. I mean, we fertilize ours along with all of our other annuals, but it brings in pollinators like you would not believe, and it blooms all season long. And then below that, Diamond Mountain Euphorbia, which was one I was trying out for the first time this last year. It's a euphorbia that gets the biggest, and it did a really good job, and it always had white blooms on it. And then below that, a row of lemon coral sedum. So we just had like four rings of stuff and it was really pretty. I liked the color choice. It was, you know, blue and white with that chartreuse green, and it was just a very cooling, peaceful area. So the last one, I think this is like number six on my list. This is just kind of an honorable mention. I don't have that much in terms of pictures or anything, but in a vlog late in the season, I think it was like toward the end of July, I had some annuals left in the greenhouse that were looking really bad. And so I cut them back and they were looking pretty scrawny and sad, and I planted them out on the west side. I just thought, you know what? I want to give these plants a chance to do something. So I planted seven purple fountain grass and then a mixture of golden butterfly, marguerite daisies, and play in the blue salvia around kind of those grasses. And it was so pretty. And I don't know if it was because I planted them so late that they all stayed like none of them got gangly or anything. They just stayed beautifully shaped after they kind of came out of their cutback that I gave them. They were full of bloom, full of color. And of course, you know, yellow and blue look really pretty together out in the garden. But that's something that I was like logging away as, you know, this would be pretty in a container or in a like a mailbox garden, something like that, where you want high color and something that's extremely low maintenance. So anyway, that is what I have for you today. I just wanted to talk through those areas and show you some of the beautiful things that like I'm reminiscing about right now and thinking about like how I can implement them differently next year, those specific plants, where I can put them and what I can pair them with. So anyway, thank you guys so much for watching this video. We'll be back with part two here soon where we go through all of our containers and show you what we really liked from last year. Thanks guys for watching, and we will see you in the next video. Bye.